application process for the highly sought H-1B visa kickstarts today. The processes began amid unprecedented scrutiny by the Trump administration and fears that a large number of applications may get rejected this time around. Shivendra Singh, Vice President, Global Trade Development and Nasscom, now joins us on the phone line. Mr. Singh, thank you so much indeed for joining us. What is the Nasscom's view on the tightening of norms by the U.S. administration on H-1B visas?
Well, thank you very much, first of all. I think if I look at it individually, they're not really big. But if you look at it collectively, then we've seen a number of moves in terms of executive orders right from 31st March 2017. We know where computer programmers were not automatically qualified as specialty occupations, and it goes on with the Buy American, Hire American executive order. Changes proposed to the labor condition applications, then changes proposed on the H-1B in terms of eligibility, employer-employee relationship, wage levels, and also the H-4 spouse visa. Taken together, all of these means constant changes which are proposed, which is not good for business, and that's where the challenge lies.
Mr. Singh, so what is the thinking within the, have you had conversation within the industry of, are you planning to lobby hard against this? Because whatever reports we're hearing so far, that there will be very little tolerance even for minor errors in visa processing. Is that a concern?
See, there are a couple of things here. First and foremost, the Indian IT industry is a net creator of jobs in the US and has done, supported more than 100,000 direct jobs. Plus, is doing a lot of value for the U.S. economy. So that's, they work with more than 75% of the Fortune 500 companies. Mm. Number two is the fact that in terms of number of H-1Bs which Indian companies hire, and when I say Indian companies, I'm looking at the top seven which accumulate for more than 90% of the visas, is less than 10,000. So it's hardly 13% of the visa cap of 65,000. But Indian nationals get 70% of the visas. Which means that they're going to American companies and non-Indian companies, which is a strong testimony to the fact that Indian nationals have these relevant STEM skills so that they are in demand globally. So the question which begs us is that till the time the STEM skills gap is there, these people are going to be required to fill in the gap. Once there is no gap, then obviously this problem will get sorted out. It's not cheap labor. Or that a lot of misperception is circled around, because you have various data, including American Department of Labor and other data, which also talk about the fact that H-1B gets equal, if not more, salaries than local American hires. It's more the STEM skills gap, and I think that needs to be bridged, because one of the biggest challenges that you see is unskilled migration gets clubbed with skilled migration. So whether Brexit has happened because of migration. And unskilled migration, whether it was the refugee crisis or many other things, there is a feeling that they take away jobs. Whereas in this case, it's not even migration; it's high-skilled worker mobility for qualified people to go and complete projects and then move to different parts of the world. So that kind of misperception needs to be absolutely cleared and clarified. And it's more a political rhetoric rather than economic rhetoric, and that needs to be clarified.
Which specifically to Indian companies, Mr. Singh, we have seen the Indian IT companies, in a sense, move away from building a model that is reliant too much on H-1B visas over a period of time. Do you see any material impact to Indian companies by virtue of this move?
Well, as you are absolutely correct. So even in 2014, the numbers were relatively smaller than what it was earlier. So that was much before President Trump came into power. So it is not at all linked to anything specific. I think the business model, as you very rightly said, changes. So as you see more of digital disruption and big data, cloud, robotics, artificial intelligence, you will see a change where a lot of companies will have to put resources nearshore, onshore, and you will see a lot of local hiring happening as we speak. So it's very much the demand of business, and that's how companies will go by.
Excuse me. Given the overall protectionist rhetoric that you're hearing from the United States, Mr. Singh, are there any conversations going on at the NASCOM level or at the government level with the United States in terms of relaxing any of these visa norms?
Well, conversations between at a government to government level continues to happen. Mm. As far as we are concerned as NASCOM, We continue to brief the government on any issue, any concern, any challenge, any good news, and they have been extremely supportive to the issue of the IT industry, because it's about a $126 billion export market, with 60% being the U.S. market. So they have, and we continue to talk directly as well to the administration as well as the legislative side in the U.S. and other stakeholders, highlighting the value which the Indian industry is bringing. So if Infosys announced 10,000 jobs between Indiana and North Carolina, if Wipro has announced 3,000 jobs, if Cognizant is spending money on STEM skills, if TCS does Carnegie Mellon, $35 million grant to Carnegie Mellon, these are important contributions which are important for the U.S. economy. And it's important that a level playing field is provided to our member companies to operate and add value to the economy. And that is what we look for, that there are no discriminatory measures, but all companies are impacted alike in case of any decision which is taken either administratively or legislatively.
We'll leave it there, Mr. Singh. Thank you so much indeed for joining us.